Hello, everybody. Welcome into a special episode of the Lakers Nation podcast. If you're joining us on Apple Podcasts, make sure you rate, review, and subscribe. Or if you're finding us on Spotify, Stitcher, wherever else you find podcasts, make sure you do the same. And if you're joining us on the Lakers Nation YouTube channel, make sure you do subscribe here. And don't forget, ring that notification bell down there to make sure you get notified every time we have a new video coming out. We have a special guest today. We've got Chris Geeter McGee from Spectrum SportsNet, one of my favorite people in the world to talk Lakers basketball with. Geeter, how are you doing, man?
Trevor, what is up, my brother? I miss you.
I miss you too, man. It's been way too long, and I'll tell you what, like I was going nuts about 45 minutes ago when that tweet came out, kind of hinting that NBA basketball may be coming back. I know you're just like me. I was taking laps around my house. I was so excited.
Yeah, you know, we're still doing a couple of shows a week, and we do it on Wednesday and Thursday. Thursday's more of a roundtable discussion. We'll have Kevin Ding on that with Ali Brez and I, but you know, today it's Wednesday. I interviewed Quinn Cook, and it's interesting just around the office too, talking to my boss. Everyone's kind of starting to make some plans and starting to figure out when our schedule is going to get a little heavier and when we're going to start doing more shows. And I think there's that optimism that it's not just if anymore, but when the NBA is returning. And I'm like you, man, I got giddy inside. I know it's going to be different. I know there's been this extended hiatus is like nothing we've ever been a part of. Mm-hmm. And I know it's a global pandemic and people are suffering and there's been a lot of tough times. But I think basketball coming back would be a huge boost for everyone. And it'll be weird without fans. Don't get me wrong. Really strange. But the fact that it's going to come back, I think, is huge, man.
Hey, Geeter, you know, you mentioned that. It's going to be strange. It's going to be different. And obviously, there's that bigger picture, right? Where people are suffering, people are struggling. And so, you know, we don't want to overlook any of that, but I think it's still okay to be excited for sports to come back, to have that little bit of normalcy. I know just for you and I, like our everyday life, considering what we do has been changed a ton, but I think just being able to give people a little bit of normalcy will be a positive step.
When tragedies happen, whether it's a death or a global pandemic, or a natural disaster, you always put those people in your thoughts and prayers first. There's no question about that. But you also have to talk about what your job is and your passion and your sports teams. It's part of life going on. And a lot of times people live through those things and it makes us feel a lot better. And basketball is one of those things. And you know this, being a lifelong Laker fan like me, it's one of those things that's made us happy our entire lives. And the thought of it coming back in a year that's already been filled with a lot of sadness, to be honest with you, with the passing of Kobe and Gigi and the seven other passengers that were on the helicopter that day in late January, to this global pandemic and the shutdown of basically the economy and everything in the world, just something we've never seen in our lifetime. It's been a tough year.
Yeah,
silver linings always occur. Yeah, you know what I was going to say? Silver linings always occur. And this year for the Lakers, it was a return to the great times that we were used to having. And it was really fun, man. And I think that got taken from us. It was hard for a lot of fans. So the fact that it can come back for especially Laker fans is huge.
Yeah, exactly. See, for the Lakers, this means so much because they're in first place in the Western Conference. You've got a 35-year-old LeBron James. He was an MVP candidate this season. You've got a real chance at getting championship 17. And I think that would just be so meaningful. And so to get Lakers basketball back, it probably means more to Lakers fans right now than it would for a Atlanta Hawks fan or something, you know, a team that's out of the running. So to get that Woj tweet from earlier saying that, you know, June 1st, NBA teams are now expecting to get some sort of guidance on bringing players back home and preparing to resume the season, that suggests very good things. I think this is something that's going to fire up Lakers fans probably more than any other fan base.
Yeah, I think, you know, Laker fans, I think Milwaukee, I think some of those teams in the top four, for sure, like, they have big dreams as well. And they're going to all fire up. Laker fans globally are going to absolutely erupt because you were starting to feel it. I mean, listen, think back to the week we had right before the shutdown. I mean, you're talking beating the Bucks and Clippers. You know, those are the three teams for me with the Lakers that have the biggest shot to win the title. So, yeah, they're regular season games. But when you end on that kind of a note, you start to go, man, we're really close, actually. Like, a legitimate chance go to the Western Conference Finals in the finals and have a real chance of winning. And it's very rare that you get to say that. Very few teams have that real chance. So, yeah, man, for Laker fans, this is like, let's go. And I think LeBron's and the players have been kind of saying that from the get-go. Like, listen, I'll play in my front yard. We'll go to a park, wherever we're going to play this season. But let's play it out. And listen, I know there will always be people, whoever ends up winning this title, there will always be the people that said, yeah, but is it watered down? Does it mean as much? Mm-hmm. I go on the other side of that. I actually think it has more meaning. I think we're going through something together globally that no one's ever gone through. And on some level, it's bigger. To come back and after a 3-month hiatus and win a title, if you're a Laker fan as well, like this team going through the death of Kobe Bryant, I just think it would be, I think this win might have even more meaning, I would argue. So for me, any team that wins it, any of these teams that go to the playoffs and win it, trust me, those guys are gonna value this title as much as they would any other year. I promise you that.
Yeah, absolutely. I think this is going to be, you know, I don't buy the whole the Shaq argument that, oh, there's going to be an asterisk by this champion, you know, no matter what. I don't think that's the case. And like you said, I think that it could have even more meaning because of everything that we've gone through here and the entire world has been going through. But I want to get your opinion on this. So there's kind of two schools of thought regarding the Lakers. And one of them being that they had all this momentum going into the league suspending the season. And so that's not a good thing that they pulled the plug. And now the Lakers are going to have to try to find that momentum again. And they're going to be up for a real challenge. And then the other side of it is, well, are a lot of the other teams going to be as focused as a veteran team like the Lakers on staying in shape during this hiatus? And might the Lakers come out of this stronger compared to the rest of the NBA? Where do you fall on things? Is it as big of a hit losing their momentum, or does the fact that they're a veteran team kind of mitigate that?
I think it's a great question. I first want to say I'm okay with Shaq and Charles and other people saying what they said. People all have their opinions, and I just, on this kind of thing, I'm totally cool with anything. And for me, I don't even want to debate. It's just how I feel. But I love your question. Can both be true? I think yes. There is no question that the Lakers' momentum was absolutely peaking and going this way. And when the suspension happened, it takes it away 100%. But it does that for every other team that has momentum. The teams that didn't have momentum and were maybe trending the other way, it could give them new life. It could re-energize them and give them a shot. And the other part is true as well. It definitely favors a veteran team still. Listen, if you're playing a short series and you got some young legs out there and some guys that don't know better and they've been hooping and you know they didn't lose anything, they might give you a run for your money. But I feel like veteran teams and guys that have been there before just know what it takes when you get into those moments, and they know how to prepare themselves during a run. And I think that's why you see so many times a team with some championship makeup, maybe one or two glue guys that have won it before. They don't even have to be star players. They're a big part of it. Maybe a coach that's been there before. It's you need those kind of pieces, and the Lakers have them all over the place. That absolutely is valuable, and it absolutely gives them advantage. So I think both your takes can be true.
Yeah, and I think that if they come out of this, I think they will have a leg up on some teams, but some other teams are going to be still focused. Like the championship caliber teams are going to be pretty focused during this hiatus. And so it'll be interesting to see how it goes. But I do like hearing all the stories that we've heard about, you know, this infamous text chain that they've got, this group chat that the Lakers have, and how they enjoy playing with each other. They enjoy each other off the floor and all of that. I think that kind of camaraderie is going to ultimately help them out. But I'm just excited to find out one way or another what the Lakers look like at this point, especially knowing that they're going to have some tough matchups in the Western Conference playoffs whenever that starts. And by the way, we got to talk about this. You ruffled some feathers recently on Twitter. You great follow there at Geeter3. This is what this was your tweet that got people all up in arms the other night. Lakers would be playing the Nuggets or Rockets right now in the Western Conference Finals. Would be so fun. And people were a little upset that there was a certain other LA team that wasn't included in your tweet.
I mean, I must have got 100 people calling me an idiot. I'm crazy. You're a loser. It was fantastic. I actually texted with Harrison Fagan last night. We were laughing because he loved it so much. And I said, you know, I just missed a little action, bud. You know, I like a little action. I like to get into it. Now, I didn't respond because I got to be honest. I was watching The Voice with my girls for my first season 18, finally watching this thing through. So I didn't have time to respond to anybody, but I did find it amazing. And so do my friends, like my closest friends that follow me. They always love they love the banter, and they just get a huge kick out of when guys go after me. But it really did upset Clipper fans. And, you know, I find that funny. People that weren't even involved in the tweet got really, really, really upset. And people that aren't even Clipper fans that live around the country, because when it got retweeted, they saw it, they were very upset with me. Is it not possible for them to lose in the second round and get upset? It could happen. They haven't been out of the second round yet. And by the way, when I heckle you or throw shade at you, for all you Clipper fans out there, you should be elated about it. You should be so excited. It means you matter and you're good. I've lived here 48 years. For 42 of them, I never knew you existed. And you're good now. And there's a rivalry for real, for once. So I get that you're always going to feel, listen, I get it as a Clipper, you're always going to feel like the Lakers get all the pub, the Lakers this, the Lakers that, the championships. You're always going to hate us. I'm fine with that. We can hate you too. Sports hate, by the way.
Sports hate.
We can hate you too. It's fun. You should be. I love that the Lakers are the most loved team in the world and the most hated. If you weren't good, no one would care, right? So I want them all to learn through this because they've never been here before. As a Clipper fan, and listen, these guys have been Clipper fans for a couple years. I get it. You're new. You're excited. And you want to get in the game and you want to get me all riled up. And listen, bud, like, just take your time. You're getting good. You're right there. Enjoy it. And by the way, I do have to say, the irony in this whole thing is I have very dear friends over there. I mean, Jamie Maggio, who's a dear friend of mine, covers Clipper games. Brian Seaman, play-by-play for the Clippers. Buddy of mine, love him. He's so good at what he does. Zubox, Lou Williams, those are two of my favorite guys. But doesn't mean I can't heckle you and hate you sports-wise. And I do.
That's something I think that you're right on. Like, that's something that is amazing to me, that for once, like, this rivalry is real to the point you and I were talking just a few minutes ago before we came on air here, that, like, we're at a point now where I've got more Lakers fans are saying that they hate the Clippers right now more than the Celtics. If anything, that should be validation to the Clippers.
You should love that. You should love that, Clipper fans. And now listen, for me, I'm older. Unfortunately, I wish I was, you know, it'd be great. You're in your 20s and you didn't even have any clue really about the Celtics to hate. But for me, listen, I grew up in the 80s. So and my dad, who's no longer here, was a diehard Laker fan as well. You got to remember, he was growing up in the 50s and 60s. So you have to understand, I was born into this Celtic hate, like a Yankee fan hates the Red Sox and the Red Sox hate the Yankees. You're just born into things. I didn't have a choice. I grew up and I hated them. Like, I wanted to beat them so bad. I would cry when they beat us, and I would be so excited when we would win. So for me, the Celtics are always what they are, right? And when it was back in 2008 and 10, we were battling again, some of the most beautiful things of all time. I think for newer Laker fans, like younger Laker fans, right. I should say, like, the Clippers have been relevant. So they see their rival that shares the building and has fans here in Los Angeles. And by the way, they have Kawhi Leonard and Paul George. They're really good. They have a great owner. Jerry West is now there. So, like, that's a good thing for the Clip. Like, if you're a Clipper fan, you should love this. And by the way, absolutely Lakers fans can hate the Clippers as much as they do the Celtics. Absolutely. I love it. Please do. That's how it should be. Do you think the Cubs cheered the White Sox winning that World Series before them? Do you think Yankee fans join the 86 parade for the Mets? Are you out of your mind? No way. And not vice versa. They all, you know, it's okay. It's okay.
Yeah, now you've got, I mean, look, the rivalry growing is great for the city, I think. It's great for the NBA, awesome. Of course, to the point where I almost feel like the Lakers and Clippers are just destined to meet in the playoffs this year. Maybe Denver knocks them off, like you're saying. Maybe it's Houston, somebody like that knocks them off, or something crazy happens, right? That's possible, but imagine the ratings, given what we've gone through, if the Lakers and Clippers meet up in the Western Conference Finals. The NBA has to just be salivating over that prospect.
And by the way, you know what my tweet was all about. It wasn't right. I mean, if I'm betting money, it's Clippers Lakers.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. There was method to the madness there for sure.
There is a collision course that was going to happen, in my opinion, and I would have banked on that. It would truly be incredible. And you could see that series just like it played out back in the 80s when the teams played each other, Boston and the Lakers, and it's back and forth. And it's one game. The Lakers are winning the series. They've found the, you know, they've exploited a matchup. And then the next game, the Clippers win, and it's their style is better. Like, that could happen for seven games. I really, truly believe that that's how fun that series would be. And I felt it was going there. I really did. And I was ready for it. I'm ready for the madness. I'm ready for Clipper fans to be going crazy and hating on me and everybody else. I was really looking forward to that. So, you know, maybe we'll still get a piece of that. But I do believe for the next, few years, multiple years, we're going to have our chances. We're finally going to have our chances.
Yeah, I can't wait. It's going to be a blast when it does happen. If the Clippers get there, we'll see. Maybe they won't. But you know what? It's going to be a lot of fun. And this rivalry has been brewing. It's been growing. And I think it's been a good thing for the league. And again, a good thing for the city. It's even to the point where like a former Clipper / former Celtic, we had Paul Pierce made his little list earlier, right, about he left LeBron James out of his top five, and Lakers fans are all upset about that, and part of that is because of who Paul Pierce is, and like we've got that type of dynamic here growing as well.
Yeah, I mean, listen, the top five lists are so amazing to me because it's really subjective. It's for me, the five that always just come to mind, and I have a hard time. For me, it'd be impossible to leave any of them out. I always go, you know, I always put Jordan as the GOAT for me. I think Kobe was the closest thing to Jordan. Jordan was just a little bit better, right? Can't argue with the numbers and the rings, but Kobe was right there for me. Like, I'm like Allen Iverson. I can't believe Kobe gets left out of GOAT conversations. It drives me insane. Like, you forget how good he was. So for me, in those conversations, you always have to have Kareem. You have to have Kareem. Six titles, six MVPs, and 38,000 points, and the rebounds and the block shots and dominating high school, college, and pro. You better have Kareem in there. You better have Jordan in there. Better have LeBron in there. Better have Kobe in there, and you better have Magic in there. I think Magic's in fifth. So for me, you know, he's my favorite player of all time. That's your top five. What you want to do with it, you go. Now, if you've got to put a Rushmore, only four, I'm struggling, man.
Yeah.
I'm really struggling. I'm having some real battles inside with myself that I can't share with you, man. I'm in that room in there, hold up for days on days on a bender thinking about what I'm going to do because I got to leave someone I really like off and I don't know who. So it'd be really hard. But, you know, that's my five for me, and I just can't even – it's not even debatable for me. I mean, Paul Pierce, come on, man. Don't have LeBron. Five, you out of your mind? Come on.
That's that Celtic bias coming in there from Paul Pierce, but that's okay. We can hate on him a little bit.
I mean, Kareem Olajuwon's not in the top 10. Larry Bird, Tim Duncan, Wilt, Oscar. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's so many. Steph, KD, these guys coming up. I mean, come on, man. It's so hard. It's so hard to do that list.
It is, and that's the whole thing. Is it makes people debate. It makes people talk, and so that's why that's why we do lists like those. Geeter, so we're looking more and more like, and we've heard confirmation on this earlier today, like if and when the NBA season does return, it's looking like Orlando. Look like we're going to Disney World, man. So what do you foresee the challenges being of doing that kind of that bubble experiment that we've heard so much about?
I think Orlando makes sense from everything I read. It's really the only way to do it. The Vegas Orlando type model, keeping kind of everyone together. Trevor, I think they got to work out so many things. And Mark Stein actually had a good tweet about it today, the bullet points of what they're looking at. And that's the testing. What happens if someone tests positive? Right. You're not shutting everything down. You're more just, you know, what are you doing in that situation? The big one for me that I keep talking about, how many teams are you taking? Trevor, I've been fighting this one a lot. I do not see, my friend, how in the world you're getting some of these teams to play. How are you getting the Golden State Warriors, the Atlanta Hawks? Why are you getting these teams? How are you getting the New York Knicks? These teams are gone. Like, they're on offseason. They've had exit meetings. If I'm Steve, why would I play Steph Curry in 10 games to get the Rockets, Clippers, and Lakers ready for the playoffs? I'm not. If I'm Luke, why am I playing De'Aaron Fox? Mm-hmm. I mean, they haven't thought of getting in, and with 14 games left, they were, what, 3 or 4 behind, just like Blazers. I mean, I know Damian Lillard is feeling that way too. It's like 4 games out with 14 to go. I mean, everyone's talking about the Pelicans making it. They were still 4 games out. Yeah. You know how much ground that is to make up? So are you risking really going for it to try to get a playoff? So what if you've been eliminated mathematically? What do you have to play for if you're a free agent or a young star? I mean, you still have to think about your future if you're that organization. So I just can't, in my mind, Trevor, I think that's another thing they're grappling with. I don't know that for a fact. That's just in my opinion. They're trying to figure out what this looks like when you come back. I think that's a big thing they're fighting through.
Yeah, that's something that I've seen. They're trying to decide, do you bring back just the playoff teams? Because those are the teams mm-hmm. that have that incentive to come back and really ramp things up. Right. Or do you say, look, we need every team to hit that magical 70 number for TV revenue and all of that. And so you bring back teams to play, what, like 5, 6, 7 games, something like that. And that's even if they're going to play regular season games at all. I highly doubt they're going to play the entire regular season. Maybe they do, but I'm skeptical on that. So I agree. I think that's a big, big question. It's not just when do they come back? It's who comes back.
Yeah. I mean, Trevor, would you play, let's say you're a team that is eliminated from the playoffs and they want you to come back for 6 games and you're going to play the Lakers twice. You're going to play the Rockets twice. You're going to play the Clippers once. You're going to play Dallas. You're going to keep it in this little bubble. Mm-hmm. You're going to play these like 4 or 5 teams. You're not playing your best players, are you?
Not if you're eliminated.
Right? Like you're not playing your young stars, right? Because you're already thinking about next season. You got a free agent that's coming up and his free agency's coming up. And he comes up to you and he goes, Coach, I have to think about myself. This is the first time that I can actually get paid. I can't come out. I can't, you know what I mean? Like there's mm-hmm. so many things that teams would really struggle with, you know, but then there'd be guys that maybe want to go out there. GB guys trying to make it, you know, those third tier guys that need to show that they can play. So you could find guys, but you can't expect teams that aren't in the playoffs to roll out their best lineup. I mean, come on, you can't. That's not even realistic to me.
No, I don't think it would even be realistic if the regular season had continued on as planned. If you were in the final, say, 5, 10 games of the season, teams start putting in their bench guys to see what they've got for next year. So, yeah, to expect like the Steph Currys of the world to get back out there and play, I think might be asking a little bit much. But bottom line, if we get NBA basketball back, I think that would be, you know, for the fans' perspective, that would be a win, just getting teams back out there on the floor. But again, the question for the league and Adam Silver is, do you even bother bringing those teams back or not? It's going to be interesting to see how they navigate that.
Trevor, for me, like baseball, golf, mm-hmm. hoops, hockey, soccer. I mean, I don't even begin to tell me we're not having football in the fall. I will not even think about that. Fantasy matters too much to me. I love football too much, college and pro. Rams open up the new stadium. For me, I know it's going to look different. Fans, man, we're going to find out in a hurry how important they are. And it is tough to – a big part of watching The Last Dance and seeing the Bulls and watching Tiger win that Masters last year when they're replaying that, a big part of it is that walk-up 18 at Augusta, is that roar you hear when Tiger hits mm-hmm. a putt. It's that roar you hear when Kerr hits that shot. When Kobe throws the alley-oop to Shaq and you've never heard Staples Center louder than that, and when Rob Ori hits the shot in game four to tie the Kings at 2-2.
Right, yeah.
You just never heard roars like that. That not happening is really weird. You know the sport of volleyball. I've been trying to tell people it almost be like a boys volleyball game at like a high school, junior college level where – basically, there's a couple moms and dads in the crowd, and it's just your team, and a guy bombs one, or there's a big block, and just your team goes wild. And it's really cool, but it's also really weird, right?
Right.
Seeing that in an NBA game or in a baseball game, there'd be something really cool about big moments, but you would miss fans.
100%. That's a great analogy for what it would be like. It would be a little bit odd, but again, given the alternative of no season, I'll certainly take it. I'll take a little bit odd and awkward, and the NBA season gets to, you know, get going again. It'll just be a new world. And I think the silver lining, we talked about the silver linings a little bit at the beginning. The silver lining would be the on-court conversations that we'll be able to hear that we wouldn't otherwise.
Trevor, I dropped this in on Frank Vogel like a month ago. We were doing a Skype interview like you and I are doing for one of our shows. I was like, Coach, have you ever thought about, because we were talking about playing with no fans. Mm-hmm. I was like, have you ever thought about what it's going to be like coaching with no fans? We will hear every single word you say on TV. And I'm telling you, he had a moment where he's like, holy, like, coaches yell a lot. Mm-hmm. They bark out things. Hearing everything is not really what you want as a coach, as you know. You like to keep some things, you know,
yeah,
to the chosen few.
Exactly. And I can't wait for it from the viewing perspective. But yes, from Frank Vogel's perspective, it'll be a little bit of a challenge. All right, Geeter. Well, hey, thank you so much for coming on. Why don't we wrap things up there? I think that's a good spot. Man, I always appreciate your work over at Spectrum Sportsnet. And thank you so much for joining us here today.
Hey, thanks for bringing up the Clipper thing. I hope you clip that and post it all. And Clipper fans, I hope we do meet. And I cannot, I love your hate tweets telling me how ugly I am. And that's why people don't want to Zoom call with me. I love all of them. So please keep coming at me. It means so much.
Bring your Clipper hate straight to @Geeter3. Go find him on Twitter.
All you Clipper fans, I used to call them the Clipper 6, but they're growing.
Yeah.
They're growing. There's a lot more of them yesterday coming at me. I was really proud, actually.
So
I was really proud.
Now it's maybe, what, like the Clippers 16 or something like that?
Get up there, man. Get up there. Keep battling. You guys are thriving. You're getting there.
Almost there. All right, man. Thank you so much for doing this. And thank you, everybody, for watching and listening. Again, make sure you do subscribe across our social channels, @LakersNation on Twitter and Facebook, @LakersNationOfficial on Instagram. Follow the Lakers Nation YouTube channel. If you want to follow me, you can find me on Twitter @Trevor_Lane and on Instagram @TrevorLaneNBA. And then, of course, you've got @Geeter3 on Twitter. Go check him out. Send him your Clipper hate and make sure you're checking him out on Spectrum Sportsnet. Till next time, everybody. Thanks again. See ya and stay safe.
Love you, buddy. See you later.